Our next speaker is Todd Jackson Jr. Mr. Jackson graduated from a degree in aerospace engineering from the University of Arizona in 2008. Upon graduation, he started his professional career in Honeywell Aerospace. In 2012, Todd transitioned from the private sector to the governmental service, including the FAA in 2016, the United States Air Force at Edwards AFB in 2019, and finally with NASA's Dryden Aeronautical Test Range at NASA's Armstrong Flight Research Center in 2020. His talk is titled, Picture Me Rolling, My Journey Through the Aerospace Industry. Please give a warm welcome to Todd Jackson.
So I want to thank the speaker for the very, very nice intro. It's definitely more than I deserve. Very happy to be here to talk about my experiences in engineering and the aviation industry as a whole. Always get enjoyment from speaking to young, ambitious, motivated people such as yourselves. And I'm really looking forward to it. And I just want to say I've been to Portland once. Oregon is a beautiful state. I really wish I could have been there in person to talk to you all. But my first experience with Portland was a little bit on the dull side. My father worked at Intel at the time, and my brother and I went up there for our spring break once. And it was just us sitting in his apartment while he went to work. We did get to go to a Trailblazers game, and that was exciting. You know, great state for what I saw, and hopefully one day I'll be able to go back and enjoy it more as an adult. Though I do hear a lot about the Voodoo Donuts, but I think that since they've expanded, so it's not maybe it's not just a Portland thing anymore. So with that said, I want to get started. Quick introduction about me. My name is Todd Jackson, project manager at the NASA Armstrong Flight Research Center, from Chandler, Arizona, graduated with a degree in aerospace engineering from the U of A back in 08, currently studying for a master's in optical sciences. I actually won't get my degree next year. It's probably 2 or 3 years from now, but steadily working on it. I've got a mixture of industry and government experience. I've worked for one aerospace company, Honeywell Aerospace, and then transitioned to the government, working for several different government agencies. I like a bunch of different things when it comes to music and hobbies, metal being primary one, but if it sounds good, I'm gonna listen to it. And then my hobbies, aviation, first and foremost, photography, pretty competitive, so. Really any sport, but tennis and bowling are my main things. And then I like to get around and travel and see different things. Let's get started from the beginning. I grew up a military brat. My father was in the Air Force, and that exposed me to aviation, more specifically fighter jets and military aviation from an early age. My dad was a mechanic, and he worked right on the flight line wherever we lived, whatever base we lived at, he was on the flight line. And I remember distinctly going to the flight line with my moms and watching the aircraft go across the flight line, giving a thumbs up to the pilots and naming the different aircraft that I saw, and of course going to air shows. So from an early age, I was really interested in aviation. I just moved into a house, and my parents, they came to help me move, and I showed them some of the books they used to read to me when I was a kid. They were these encyclopedias of military aircraft, and they were really surprised that I still have them. So that just tells you how ingrained my passion for aviation was when I was a young child. But of course, we grow up, we find different things, we find different things that we're interested in. And my love for aviation, while it was still there, of course, I still played flight sims, still went to air shows, still like to watch shows about military aircraft, but a lot of my interests became centered around the internet and computers, specifically building computers and computer gaming, getting into a little bit of programming, building websites. So as I was progressing into high school, my interest started to shift. And I thought to myself, oh, well, you know, maybe I want to become a computer engineer. And that's what I chose. When I first started in college back in 2002, I thought to myself, you know what, I want to do this computer engineering thing. I want to build and help program computers. And really, it was just an extension of what my hobby was at the time. I didn't have a long-term goal as to where I wanted to end up in that particular career field. I just knew that I liked computers. I liked computer games. I actually liked computer games too much. That got me into a little bit of trouble when I was in college. And that was what I wanted to pursue. The problem with that was that part that I just mentioned, I like computer games too much. So I ended up blowing off my studies, neglecting my studies to enjoy the high-speed internet connection I had in my college dorm to play video games. I was skipping classes, wasn't really studying. And I mean, I even had friends who were like, hey, you know, you're missing classes. What are you doing? And I was not focused. I was not focused on doing well, because I just assumed, because high school was a bit of a breeze for me, that college was going to be the same way. And as everybody here probably knows, college is a bit different. Responsibilities are different. The material is a bit more difficult, and you do actually have to apply yourself to do well. But I wasn't jiving with any of that at the time. So got into a bit of trouble, went on academic probation, and started to think to myself, you know, maybe this engineering thing isn't for me. Why don't I just go to computer science? And I discovered really quickly that I wasn't a big fan of programming and coding all day. It was something that I could do if I needed to do it, but I didn't necessarily have a gift or an extreme interest in programming all day. So very quickly changed my major from that. Was in political science for a little bit, thinking, oh, you know, maybe I want to be a lawyer. My mom told me once, you like to argue, you might be a good lawyer at some point. And I just ran with that. I found out, you know, I don't really like reading legal briefs or typing copious pages of notes or information on legal case studies. So then I became undecided. And at that point, I was still blowing off my studies, even though I was undecided. And I remember talking to my mom once, because again, I found myself on academic probation once more. I remember telling her, maybe this engineering thing, or maybe this college thing is not going to work out for me, which was the absolute wrong thing to say to my mom. And she quickly corrected me and said, no, you definitely need to go to college and finish. You just have to find something that you're passionate about. What about airplanes? You've always loved airplanes. Have you thought about aerospace engineering? And switched the light bulb off my head. I was like, yeah, you know, I do. I do like airplanes. I do like aerospace engineering. I am somewhat interested in aerospace engineering, even though it might be a bit more difficult. So I followed her advice, which, again, she's been a very, very instrumental and influential influence on me. And I went to aerospace engineering. And that's not to say that things got easier for me, but now that I had the passion, I had rediscovered my passion, I had the resolve and the conviction to persevere through the difficult course material and to study and, of course, figure out how I could network and study with other people who maybe understood the material better than I did to be successful. And that's not to say that things got easier. They did not. They got a lot harder because the course material was more difficult. But I was able to stay the course and continue on to my graduation. And some of the things that helped me get there was, of course, making sure that I surrounded myself with good people. I joined the Society of Hispanic Engineers, the National Society of Black Engineers, and then a few major specific clubs and organizations, and they really helped me grow my passion and surrounded me with people who had a similar passion so that I could find people to study with or just to commiserate with when courses were a bit difficult or a test was particularly hard. I had that support network in addition to my parents and family members to help me keep going when things got difficult. Here I am in San Diego. It was me and my brother and my dad, again, visiting him while he was doing a work thing. We drove down to the Marine Corps Aerospace Museum, and it was helping to keep that fire ignited in me, seeing those aircraft and thinking to myself, you know, one day I could do that. Of course, NASA didn't come into the picture until later. I didn't have a great GPA, so I didn't think that I could apply, even when I was encouraged to apply to some of the internship programs. And even when I got close to graduation, I was encouraged to apply, but I didn't really understand how to do it. I didn't know that NASA was a government agency, and I just didn't think I was smart enough at the time. So that's just a lesson to don't self-eliminate. You have to be confident in who you are and your skills and abilities and knowledge, and also find out if you are eligible or not. Don't just think that you aren't because you don't think that you have the GPA or you don't think that you have the knowledge you need to work at a place. You have to do your due diligence and make sure that if it really is the case that maybe you don't meet the criteria, find a way to improve that deficiency or see if there's another way in. And as I was talking about, I joined a few major specific groups as well as social organizations. Here's me with my senior design team. We had just finished presenting a micro air vehicle design, and these people were really instrumental in helping me to graduate, to succeed, and to stay the course because we all were going through something at the same time. So we had a close bond. We could help each other with homework, help each other study for tests. I was really grateful for these people. And then, of course, on the cultural side, being able to fellowship with people who looked like me and were going through the same struggles, maybe didn't have the same cultural background, but still knew what it was like to perhaps be a minority in a specific discipline or major. That was really something that helped me make it through those challenging times. So I got my degree, I graduated, and I went into private industry working at a place called Honeywell Aerospace. And this was another transition for me because, one, just like in college, I was on my own, but this time I was on my own and I had bills to pay in addition to the work that I was doing. And not only that, but I had disposable income. So I could pursue my hobbies and my passion with a bit more intention than I could when I was in college. And in fact, this goes back to my parents being some of my biggest supporters. They, for Christmas, they got me flying lessons. They handed me the flying lessons and they said, hey, here you go, son. You don't have any more excuses. If you want to pursue, if you want to get your pilot's license, you can do it. So I took that certificate and I got the ball rolling. I started taking pilot lessons. I was really enjoying it. And I remember I took a trip to San Diego for another air show with some friends, and I saw someone there with a flight suit. I thought he was a pilot. In fact, he was a flight doctor or a flight physician. But anyway, I started speaking to him and I just asked him, I've got my degree. What can I do if I want to potentially pursue being a pilot in the military? And he was very gracious with his time. He told me about his path and how he got there and what I would need to do in order to join the military and go for a pilot slot. So I stayed in touch with him once we left San Diego, and I was wrestling with the fact of, well, what do I want to do? Do I want to become a pilot, or do I just want to stay as an engineer? Of course, I'm taking the flying lessons. Well, when you're taking flying lessons, eventually you get to the point where you can fly and land the aircraft on your own. And your instructor essentially gets out of the plane and says, hey, I want you to go do this. I want you to take off here. And then I want you to come back and land. And I want you to do it X amount of times. And that's the experience I had. The instructor got out of the plane after we had taxied into the hangar area, and he said, hey, you're ready to go. I want you to go up, do three touch and goes, and then come back here. So that's what I did. I went up, I did it, and I came back, and I thought to myself, this is incredible. This is exactly what I want to do. I'm going to try to join the military and become a military pilot, and a fighter pilot specifically, because I mean, we've all seen Top Gun. Like, that they make it seem like the coolest thing in the world. So I had decided that I was going to do that, and literally the night after I made that decision, I had a cardiac arrest. I woke up in the hospital one day and I was looking at my dad and I asked him, hey, you know, what happened? I thought that I had joined the military and I had been involved in a training accident of some sort. And he just told me, no, you were 5 minutes from the house you were staying in, and you basically fell out and your roommate resuscitated you, and you're in a hospital. He told me that it was a cardiac arrest, and I looked, and in fact, I had a scar on my chest because I had a implanted cardiac defibrillator in my chest now. And he was just telling me everything that happened, and I was just shocked. I didn't know what to say because I had no recollection of it. And here I was in a situation that's out of my control, and what I'm wanting to do, I clearly haven't done, and now I'm unsure if I will be able to do it. And unfortunately, that was confirmed about a few months after I got out of the hospital. The doctor told me, it's going to be quite difficult. You most certainly would not be able to become a military pilot because you couldn't get a medical exemption, and it might be challenging for you to become a general aviation pilot as well, because again, you won't be able to get that medical certificate. This was a crushing blow for me, and it just started a period of reflection. I wouldn't say listlessness, because I still had my job, I still had my passion. I was doing other things outside of engineering, volunteering, STEM education, and community service. So plus my hobbies of traveling, photography, and painting and sports. So I still had those things, but my sense of purpose was slightly askew, because I you know, this was the goal that I was working towards, and I was certain that I was going to achieve it. And then all of a sudden, due to circumstances beyond my control, I couldn't. And you go through a period of self-pity, thinking, oh, woe is me, what can I do? But after that grieving period, I had to get back on track. I had to find a way to move on and get back at it, essentially. So the turning point came for me when I went to a flight test. As an engineer, we were building a component, and we got to the point where we needed to test that component on the actual aircraft to figure out whether or not it was ready to be produced. And we're out there, we're at an Air Force base in North Carolina. That's an F-15 behind me. We're getting the F-15 ready. And all of a sudden, I see an individual come out, and it's this gentleman wearing a flight suit, but he had a like crazy hair, clearly not military standard hair, not a military haircut. So I was looking real hard at him, thinking he's clearly not in the military. He's a bit older, and his hair is crazy. There's got to be something to this. So I went up to him and I asked him, "Hey, what are you like? What is your job? Why are you here?" And he, again, he was very gracious with his time, and he just told me, "I'm a flight test engineer. I work for the Air Force." And again, that concept of being a non-military civilian and working for the government was still somewhat foreign to me. And he just said, "This is what I do." And I after he told me all this, I was like, "This is amazing. This is something that I wanted to do," because he was sitting in the back of the aircraft while the aircraft was running. He was operating some of the systems during the test. I just thought that was really impressive, and it was something that I could see myself doing. So I asked him, "How do I get to where you are?" He referred me to his boss, and I spoke with his boss. And before we left North Carolina, he gave me a paper, and it had a list of different test sites where flight test engineers were utilized. And I kept that. In fact, I still have it. And next time when I update the slides, I'll actually have a picture of it. And I started researching these different areas and how I could become a flight test engineer. And while I was doing that, the whole NASA thing popped back into my mind, because I realized that NASA was an aerospace company, or really an aerospace agency, and that I certainly didn't think that I could work there as a student, but I felt like I had a better chance now that I had experience. I just didn't know how to get in. And the crazy thing is, my godfather actually works for a NASA agency, and I still, like, it just never occurred to me, hey, maybe you could ask him how he made it. So that's something I did. And I also was fortunate that during this time frame in the late aughts, NASA had a public-facing employee directory. And I emailed a person who worked at the NASA Langley Research Facility, and I asked them, "Hey, you know, I read an article about your experiences. How could I become a NASA employee?" And again, I'm very gracious with their time and willing to talk to a complete stranger. This person emailed me back and told me what they did and how they did it, how they got to be in the position and fly in the back of the jet as the article about them had described, and what I would need to do if I wanted to do something similar or work at NASA, as well as flight test opportunities. And he came at it from a different angle than the military or the DOD guy did. he told me, here are a number of civilian agencies like NOAA and a few NASA centers and private companies that employ flight test engineers, and this is how you do it. So I took that information and I built my resume and I started applying. I went to a few career fairs, wasn't really getting a lot of bites, which at the time, I when I think back to it, one, it was in the late aughts. The economy was still recovering. The aerospace industry had taken a big hit. And two, I hadn't networked enough. I still was, you know, I was definitely interested in aviation. The passion was there, but I wasn't going out and talking to people about what I wanted. And I didn't necessarily have a mentor. I had mentors with me at the company that I worked for at Honeywell, but I didn't have mentors outside of Honeywell who could look for opportunities that were non-Honeywell, or opportunities at NASA, opportunities at these other companies that hired flight test engineers. So that's what I had to start doing. I started building that network up, and it just so happened that I had a high school classmate who worked at one of the sites that the Air Force flight test engineer had put on the paper that he gave me. So I told him, hey, I'm really interested in working where you work. He happened to work at a place called Pax River, a naval air facility. And I told him, I really wanna work there. How do I do it? And that got the wheels in motion. It was very quick. Within a month, I was interviewing, and then within 3 months, I had a job offer and essentially orders to move out to Maryland, where Pax River is, to start working there as an engineer. So that it happened very quickly, but it was a seminal moment in my life. I had never lived on the East Coast. I had grown up, I had essentially spent a decade or so in Arizona, and it was a new experience, new culture, you know, new scenery, new organization. And I at that point, I was ready to embrace it. So I was quite happy to move on and go to Pax River. Now, I can't say that things happened as quickly as I thought they were, as I thought they would. I thought that I would become a flight test engineer because I wasn't hired as a flight test engineer. I was hired for the experience I had working for that private industry company. I was doing the same thing just for the government. And I thought to myself, well, I'll find an opportunity since I'm out here, I'll find an opportunity in flight test engineering. It didn't happen like that. It just so happened that I would work in the propulsion, which is what I was doing in private industry for another year. And then I would take what is called a rotation or a detail into a human systems lab doing optical engineering, looking at night vision goggles and lighting in aircraft cockpits for another year or so, which was actually a great opportunity. I got to sit in jets. I was seat qualified, ejection seat qualified, and I learned something new about aviation and how humans interact with the aircraft and why it's important to engineer the systems that the humans will interact with in a way that it's easy or intuitive for them to interact with them. And of course, how visual acuity and light in the cockpit affects their performance. I learned a number of things that I wouldn't have even considered had I gone straight to flight test. And plus, I picked up some mentors, good friends. It was a fantastic experience. But if I had not been open, if I had been single tracked and narrowly focused on just being a flight test engineer, I wouldn't have had the opportunity to do it. But in either case, I was in electrical optics or in human systems for a year, and then another person I worked with who was in the same group made a change to flight test engineering. And because I had a good relationship with him, he's a mentor. In fact, he's still a mentor. He helped me get into grad school. He recognized that I wanted to be where he was, and he pulled some strings. He gave me a good recommendation, and within a couple of months, he brought me with him into flight test. So I worked as I became a flight test engineer, and I really enjoyed it. As you can see, I got to cosplay as a pilot. That's during a training. In addition to that, I got some more qualifications. I was able to operate some of the systems in the aircraft. We would do testing in what's called an anechoic chamber. I was involved in all of that, and I loved it. But a part of me was still thinking about NASA, and it was just something I had to prove to myself. I wanted to prove to myself that I had what it took to be a NASA employee. And at that point, I had really felt that I could do it, because I knew that some of the systems I was working on, NASA also worked on. So I had that direct experience. In addition to that, the Navy really helped me burnish and develop my leadership skills, my speaking skills, my writing skills, presentation skills. So I felt that I was a more complete package as an engineer, and that would be enough to help me get a position at NASA. But at the same time, I was conflicted, because I enjoyed what I was doing with the Navy, and I had a lot of opportunities. Grad school wasn't in the picture yet, but it was something that I was thinking about, and the Navy has a very robust continuing education program. In addition, I like living on the East Coast. I didn't like the winters, but I definitely liked the cultural diversity. The going to the big cities, Washington, D.C. is my favorite city. And it's because of the time I spent there, I really had a chance to fall in love with the city and grow as an individual. Going up to Philadelphia and New York, they weren't far away. Family members in the South, in Virginia, North Carolina, Tennessee, everyone, all those opportunities were available to me by living on the East Coast. So I was conflicted about leaving that particular area for one of the NASA Aerospace Centers, which actually one was on the East Coast, but the one I was looking at was the one that I work at now. It was what was then the Dryden Aeronautical Center. They had a lot of interesting programs going on that I thought would really benefit me in my career, and I thought I could contribute to, but I just didn't know. I didn't know how to get in. I didn't know how I would find my way from the East Coast working for the Department of Defense to a NASA center in the middle of the desert, especially since I didn't know anybody there. So again, that public directory, that public facing directory really helped me. I just so happened to be doing some research, looking up NASA Dryden on YouTube, and this video came up with this individual. She was at the time, she was a manager, a project manager, in fact, talking about her experiences. Her name was Lori Grindle. And I looked Lori Grindle up, and I sent her an email from my Navy email to her NASA email, not really expecting to hear back, but sure enough, I heard back from her, and we spoke on the phone, and I was telling her, I'm really at an inflection point in my career. I think that maybe I want to move on from where I'm at, but I'm not sure how that's going to impact my career. And she listened to me, and she gave me some good advice. She's like, hey, you know, you have to be open to newer experiences in order to grow and develop your career. And if you really miss working for the Navy, if you really miss working for the DoD, well, you can always go back at some point. And that was all I needed, right? That was the boost that I, the confidence boost that I got to look for positions at NASA, particularly the NASA Dryden Center, and apply. So I applied to them. I applied to some positions that I knew I was qualified for, and then other positions that I wasn't sure that I was qualified for. But again, I wasn't going to self-eliminate at this point. I was going to pursue the opportunity as best as I could, and again, let the chips fall where they may. Sure enough, I got an interview for a position that I was highly qualified for. In fact, it was working on the same aircraft system that I was working on as a flight test engineer. I did very well in the interview, and I got an offer. But at this point, that whole personal aspect of enjoying the East Coast and having built a support network and friendships, that was something that I also had to consider. So I was looking at the offer, and at the same time, I got an offer from the Federal Aviation Administration, and I'm considering these two offers. And when I thought of the pros and the cons of leaving the East Coast, the cons were just too big. I really enjoyed living on the East Coast. I enjoyed getting to know family members that I hadn't known. I enjoyed the friendships that I had built there. And plus, the FAA position was in Atlanta, a place that I had always wanted to live. And in addition to that, they offered a very good relocation package. And what sealed it for me was my manager at the time, or my prospective manager, the person who interviewed me, telling me, people like you who like to do a lot of different things, they do very well here. So that particular statement, on top of all of the things that I enjoyed about being on the East Coast and the personal relationships I had, that convinced me that, okay, you know, I want to do this. I want to work for NASA, but this just isn't the right time for me to do it. And again, I thought about what Lori told me. You can always go back, or you could always try again. And that stuck with me. I was like, okay, well, maybe now is not the right time. I'm going to pursue the FAA opportunity, and then when the time is right, I'm going to apply to NASA again. And it was a very hard conversation telling the person I had interviewed with that I wasn't going to take the job, because that's something I do after every interview. I try to get feedback. She told me that I had done a great job. I clearly had known what I was talking about. I showed that I was willing to learn, and in the areas that I maybe wasn't as strong in, I was trainable, coachable. It's a term they use in athletics. I was coachable, and that as she told me, you know, I really hope that one day I see you here at NASA Dryden, which was very heartening to me, and it helped me cope with the fact that I had gotten very close to realizing my goal of working for NASA, but it just wasn't the right time. And with that, I packed up. My dad came out to DC. My mom did too, but my dad came and helped me pack up a van, and I moved down to Atlanta. So when I talk about the network and things that I had done outside of work, this is one of them. Volunteering in a STEM organization, helping younger people, reaching back, as my elders would say, helping younger people discover their passion and their motivation for doing whatever they want to do in life. that was something that was ingrained in me from my parents, but I really got to experience it on the East Coast, and in particular at PAX and in Maryland. And that's, as I was saying, it's really something that made me or made me want to stay on the East Coast a little bit longer, because I just really enjoyed those opportunities and the friendships and relationships that I had developed there. And in fact, I still talk to a few of these kids every now and then. Of course, they're not kids anymore, they're adults. One just graduated from college. I was out in North Carolina to watch him graduate. That was an extremely fulfilling opportunity. So again, I've grown as a person and as a professional out in PAX, and it was just a really special place to be, and just being able to not be terribly far from DC and Atlanta, and being able to go back and visit people, that was something that was really important to me. And again, it's part of the reason why I decided to stay on the East Coast and just went down to the FAA. So the FAA, it's a bit different from, it was not just a bit different, it was very different from the DOD, a bit more buttoned up, a bit more formal, because we are representing the legislative side of the aviation industry. I got to learn a lot about safety and the national airspace, why planes fly in those, you know, if you go to an airport, why you're seeing planes fly in the what's essentially a single file line as they approach the airport to land, everything that it took to maintain the system, the engineering that went behind it, the oversight that went behind it, why safety was so important. And of course, going up to an air traffic control center or a TRACON, a terminal approach radar facility, and seeing what everybody does there to keep things moving efficiently, that was amazing. And not only that, I got to get involved in safety investigations, though, of course, they're exciting at the time. They're a bit less exciting if somebody's been hurt, but getting to the root cause and figuring out how things worked, that was amazing to me. And not only that, I had the opportunity to indulge in that writing, that particular aspect of being a professional that I was trying to avoid when I changed my major from political science, I was actually having to engage in it. And thankfully, I had been trained and trained well by the Navy on how to write. And I ended up writing what's called an airworthiness directory, which is actual policy, federal policy that goes into the aviation industry, and it creates rules that they have to comply with. So I did that, and I got to engage with different aviation regulatory bodies from across the world, EASA, the European FAA, the Canadian FAA, things that I had very little knowledge about before working for the agency, I became very familiar with. And it was a fantastic opportunity, but I was getting a little bit antsy. It was an office job, strictly office job. The only way that I could get out of the office was when I would tag along with the airport inspectors. But of course, that wasn't my main job. So I was getting a little bit antsy, and I thought to myself, oh, you know, my technical skills are starting to wane. Like, certainly the soft skills and my leadership, presentation, communication skills, those had been burnished and strengthened at the FAA. But I thought of myself as still technical. I want to still be able to calculate lift and drag and get some numbers and do some analysis if I need to. And I can't do that with the FAA, which wasn't true. In fact, I was doing it when I was evaluating designs. I was using those technical skills I had developed when I was evaluating designs and approving them. But that was just my mind. In my mind, I was just thinking to myself, oh, I'm going to lose all of my technical skills if I stay here for the rest of my career. So I started getting the itch. And plus, I had been on the East Coast for a while. Didn't like Atlanta as much as I thought I would. So
a quick warning, we're running out of time, so please start to wrap it up. Thank you very much.
Oh, okay. How much time do I have?
You have about like 5-ish minutes.
Okay, great. No, we're almost at the end. So,
right, thank you.
Yep, no problem. So, I wanted to go to California, or wanted to go back west. I was ready to go back home, get away from the snow, and it snowed everywhere I lived, and I was really tired of that. So I applied to NASA Dryden again, and then I also applied to the Air Force and a few private companies, and I actually applied to the same group I applied for when I was with the Navy. Didn't get the job, but of course got a good end of or after action report about what I could improve. Did get the job with the Air Force. So I went to the Air Force for about a year doing EOIR optical stuff that really helped me discover that, yes, that's what I want to do. I want to get a master's degree in optical sciences. So I was able to use that. I was able to use that passion to write a good application letter and submit a good application package. And plus the network I had developed, Lori Grindle, my senpai, my EOIR senpai at PAX, and a few other people, they wrote great letters of recommendation for me. And that really helped me to get into grad school. So I was at the Air Force for a year, and sure enough, another opportunity came up with NASA. I applied to it, but this time I had the advantage of Lori Grindle now being a division head and someone who had a lot of stature and a good reputation at NASA, what is now NASA Armstrong and was NASA Dryden at the time. She told me, hey, I know these individuals, I know about this position, here's what you need to do to be ready for the interview, and also let them know that I am one of your references. And sure enough, I knocked it out of the park for the interview, but what I think really got my foot in the door was Lori, because when I told my manager, or the hiring manager, who my references were, and I mentioned her, he's like, oh yes, I know her very well. And she gave me a glowing review, and sure enough, got into NASA, had achieved that lifelong, or career-long goal, and got to work on some very interesting stuff, like building a mobile operations facilities for autonomous or soon to be autonomous electric vehicles, and just meeting a bunch of incredible and passionate people. That was a really great experience. And then once more, Lori came through and I actually went to her group, the project management group. She held the door open for me and allowed me to become a project manager working on UAS systems, which she knew from our conversations was something I was very passionate about. So if she hadn't been there, I wouldn't have that opportunity. And that brings me to my personal philosophy. You can see this on YouTube or really anywhere. If you put it in Google, there's an interview with Bruce Lee where he talks about being water, being flexible and adaptable. And that's what's really helped me be successful and get to where I am. Being adaptable, being able to do different things, not shying away from opportunities because I don't think that they necessarily fit my skill set or what I want to do. I embrace them and give them the benefit of the doubt and explore the possibility as much as I can. And then, of course, I've got a team. I've got people who support me. I've got mentors, and then of course I've got the the hobbies, the things that sustain me outside of work, in addition to an innate curiosity or just being curious about the world and other things and wanting to learn how they work. That's what helps me develop the goals and stay focused on those goals and to make sure that I pursue them with the same dedication as I do my personal hobbies. So that's all to say that I am more than willing to be on your team and to be of assistance however I can through your journey. So feel free to drop me a line at todd.j.jackson@nasa.gov. I will do my best to stay in touch. If you've got questions and I've got the answer, I'll answer them. If I don't have the answer, I'll find someone who does. I'm here to help. And I really hope that my story has helped. And if there are any questions, I'm more than willing to answer them right now. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Todd. We have time for one question from the audience. Their question is, now that you've been in the industry and government for so long, looking back, what classes were most useful to you and what should we really focus on for the future?
That's a great question. So this maybe this is a surprise, but the class that was most influential for me, especially in this position that I'm in now, was technical communication. Because you have the core curriculum, so you're going to learn how to be that disciplined engineer, whether it's aerospace, mechanical, electrical, what have you. Your school and your curriculum is going to make sure that you have those skills. It's the soft skills that you have to develop and you really have to pursue on your own, so to speak. You have to be able to work in groups, communicate effectively in groups, deal with conflict management, know how to make an effective presentation. That is, and I would say that technical communication, if that's available, that's really something that can help you with your career. And then honorable mention, matrix math. I took a matrix math course. It kind of helped me with MATLAB, learning determinants and inverse matrices and why some matrices can't be multiplied based on their dimension. That was really interesting to me, and it helped me. Unfortunately, I took it after I took the MATLAB class, which was kind of annoying. But that was a good class too. But technical communication, that I would say that's the best thing. Learning how to communicate with other people and getting your ideas across, getting your point across, that's going to be key for you in your career.
Awesome. Thank you very much. We'll email you more audience questions after the event. But thank you again for joining us today and wish you the best of luck.
All right. Thank you. I really enjoyed the opportunity. And again, if there's anything that I can help you with, get at me. Take care, everyone.
Take care.